I'd like to share with you a true story that happened to someone in living in a very observant community, and the fellow unfortunately is not addicted but very much with cigarette. He needs to smoke a cigarette all the time, and one time he looked at his pocket of the cigarette, but there is no matches. So what did he do? He went outside of one of those big shuls. It was a winter time, and he noticed at the entrance there is a place that people put their long coat. And obviously, he, with his obsession to smoke a cigarette, he started checking coats. And sure enough, he found the coat that they have those cheap matches. You can buy it for like $2 or something.
Lighter.
So he took that, and sure enough, he smoked the cigarette. But before he took it, he saw the name of that person on that coat. No, time passed by, and how do you call this fellow? What is the real name? The real name, it's in Hebrew and Yiddish, Ganev, right? The person is a thief, regular thief. Now, we get to the Chodesh Elul, good morning. We go to the time of preparation for Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur. The fellow start thinking about Teshuvah. So he went to that shul, he started searching for that person, and they told him, sorry, this person is now in England. Now the question is, what is the halacha? Does he need to go and travel to England to give back the light to that person? Does he need to go to the post office or UPS or Federal Express and mail him whatever several dollars that light's worth? Or you said that since it's a question if it's shaveh pu'utah, right? If it's a value, if it's a value? No, that's one school of thought. But let's think the other way around as well. Let's say that fellow, let's say the person who is the thief, the stealer, let's call him Abraham. Now, the other fellow, his name is, let's say, David. Now, David approached Abraham and he said to him, I want my light back. And Abraham said, what are you talking about? I never use your light. He says, in a surveillance, you can see in the camera, right? The camera shows that, guess what? That you stole my light. I want to smoke a cigarette. By the way, I never smoke. So the other guy said, I never did it. He says, I show you. He says, you're wrong. Something wrong with the surveillance. And he took an oath. And then time passed by. We reach Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. And guess what? That fellow feels bad. And he wants to do teshuvah. So what do we do with him? We have the Torah. What did the Torah say? If someone stole something, right, Yehuda? Someone stole something and he makes a false oath. You remember what we learned? He needs to pay the keren, which is the principal. He needs to pay chomesh. Is what chomesh? Is another additional fine of 20%. And he need to bring a special sacrificial offering that it's called asham, a guilt offering. So the question is, what do you do in this? I give you another scenario so you see how important is the daf today. Bava Kama, page 105. It was two neighbors that live in the same building, and one of the neighbors needs to go overseas right away. He needs to fly to Singapore. And it's not just that, he gets this notice from those company, let's say Cyprus company, one of those company that said it's urgent, it's a client that it's an urgent need, you have to catch a plane right away and go there. Fine. So he doesn't know his neighbors so well. So he have no choice. He knocks his door. So he knocks his neighbor door and he said, look, I have here a box. This box is full of very valuable things, jewelry, diamonds, all kind of things, watches. I want you to watch over this. The neighbor said, fine. And the fellow, the Cyprus program chair, flew to Singapore. Guess what happened? When he returned, he knocked the door of the neighbor and he said to him, I need my box back. And he, for sure, he smiled ear to ear and he gave back the box. So he thanked him very much. He went to his house. But then he opened the box and guess what? The Rolex disappeared. He have an expensive, like $15,000 Rolex, and it disappeared. So he went to his neighbor, and he said, do you know what's going on with my Rolex? And the neighbor said, I never saw a Rolex in this box. So later on, it turns that this stupid neighbor went to his house of worship and he told some of his friends how beautiful watch he had, and that friend was a friend of that fellow, and it turns that he took it, but that's not the end. When he told people this Rolex, somebody there, guess what, stole it from him as well. So you have, right? Let's use the name. Max is the neighbor. And the fellow is Ruby. And Ruby gave to Max the box. Max stole the Rolex. And then Max went around and proudly said that he have this Rolex. And then you have Eddie that stole from Max the Rolex. Right? So, guess what happened? This Max went to a special investigation. Right? Ruby took David and he did detective work, and he have a very serious examination with Max, and Max agreed that he took it from Ruby, but he said somebody else stole it from me. And they check him, how do you call it, with a lie detective, and it turns that is true. So by halacha, he's considering shomer chinam. Shomer chinam, it means that you guard over someone without getting paid. And by halacha, shomer chinam patur. It's exempt. But in this page 105, we're going to learn that if shomer chinam kofer bifnei ha-be'alim, if that no paid guard deny to the owner that he never deposit, he never have something, for example, the Rolex, so that very moment he become a thief, he changes status from a shomer chinam, from free of charge guard, to a regular thief, and therefore he needs to pay Ruby, the owner, his watch, his Rolex. Okay, so we are page 105, 8 lines from the top of the page. Chutz mipachot shaveh pruta bakeren. The Mishnah said, if the victim forgave the robber for stealing, forgave for the principal, for the chomesh for 20%, excluding less than value of pruta in a keren, which is the principal. Amar Rav Papa limited, Rav Papa circumscribed it, and he said, lo shanu, the sages did not say, that he needs to go after the victim, Ela she'en gzela kayemet, which means the something that is a less than the value of pruta, let's say used lighter. Obviously, most probably is less than pruta, right? Matches, bucks, small bucks, less than shve pruta. So he said, it's not considering chov mamon, it's not considering you owing money, per se. Aval gzeila kayemet, but if it's still there, which means it doesn't change the status, it wasn't lost, tzarich leilech acharav, needs to go. So basically, I just want you to know the vignette in halacha. By halacha, we go by the Rav Papa. But first, let's see what they said. Chayshinan, we are concerned, Shema Tiyaker, that maybe that stolen item will appreciate the value, and the debt he owes will exceed the value of one pruta. So therefore, is no atonement. Rambam. Let me read for you the Rambam, Ilchot Gzeila Va'aveida, chapter 7. It is no different when the stolen item is extant. There is no concern that the stolen item currently worth less than one pruta will appreciate the value. Accordingly, a robber who retains a stolen item worth less than one pruta, as we said, the lighter, the matches in our example, is not obligated to return to the robbery victim, right? So he doesn't need to run after him to whatever it is, England, right? The robbery victim may locate the robber and collect his item. The halacha is therefore, according to the second version of Rav Papa's statement, that's also in Choshen Mishpat 367. So Ika de Amri, there is another, and that's the second one we're about to hear in Rav Papa. And again, this is just a Shmua, it's saying on behalf of Rav Papa. Amar Rav Papa lo shna gzeila kayemet, velo shna she'en gzeila kayemet. There is absolutely no difference if the stolen item is extant or not. Meaning, it's no different if something that is less than the value of pruta is in the hand of the robber, or if it's not. Eino tzarich leilech acharav, l'shem atiyaker lo chayshinan. They say that we are not concerned that perhaps it will appreciate its value. So, simply speaking, what the Gemara tried to say that there is no concern for change the status, that it's worth more. Now, the Rosh, Rabbeinu Asher, said that usually less than the value of pruta, a person is mochel, a person is let go, you know? But here, it's a little different. It's a famous story about the Chafetz Chaim, the great rabbi of Radin, right? The one who wrote the Mishneh Berurah. So one time he went with Eglon. In those days they have horses and wagon, and that's the way they travel. So the fellow was crying out to Chafetz Chaim, his financial situation, his life situation. And he says, "What? Why God did it to me? Why it happens? I'm a good person." So the Chafetz Chaim looked at him and he says, "Let's talk honestly. You have your horses. From time to time, did you stop in the field that belonged to someone? You collect some hays, some stalks that are around, and you give it to your animals? You do all kind of small things here and there?" So the guy said, "Hey, yeah. I do that sometimes, but you know what? You're a big rabbi, and you just told me you went on a train and somebody stole from you. Why, you deserve that?" So the Chafetz Chaim said to him, "You should know that no one No one is super, super godly, right? That's one of the things that in Judaism we don't believe in those saints, in those entities, the human. We are human, no matter who you are, we're human. He says, look, I'm selling a set of Mishnah Berurah. Okay? It's not intentional, but think about it. It happens sometimes in the printing process that people get a book and some pages are missing, some pages are scrambling and you don't see the words. Right? So, guess what? No one is free from everything. By me, it's different. It's shogeg, it's unintentional, but it's still a problem. I sold you a set with understanding that it's a set and it's some pages missing, right? Anyway, Amar Rava. So here, Rava gives us example with in regards to returning a stolen item that it turns so low that is less than pruta. So for example, you go to a gas station, you bought this lighter, right? You bought it for $4 and now it's worth 20 cents, right? Amar Rava, gazal shalosh agudot b'shalosh prutot. Someone who robbed another of three bundles of goods that worth three prutot totally. Now, unfortunately, ve'uzlu ve'amdu al shtayim. Now the worth only two. Im hechzir lo shtayim. If already the robber returned to the victim two bundles, chayav le'achzir lo acheret. He is obligated to do what? To give the third or value of pruta that that's worth. Now, if he took an oath, right? So he needs to send or give that payment to the victim. Even at the time that one aguda, one bundle, it's not in the value of pruta. But since the original time that was stolen from the victim, it was worth more than pruta, so you have an obligation to return it.
So, okay. So in the situation, for example, with the lighter, if he like gets it and then uses up all the lighter fluid in it, then obviously it's not worth the pruta anymore, but it may have been more than pruta before. So in that case was when the value when he stole it.
Beautiful. I will share with you, follow what you said, the Shulchan Aruch Hoshel Mishpat 360. One who robbed another of three bundles worth three prutot in total and then returned two of them after the value had depreciated to two prutot in total is obligated to return the third bundle to the robbery victim since it was worth one pruta at the time of a robbery. That's from the Koran translation, Rabbi Steinsaltz, God bless him, a translation of the Shulchan Aruch, right? Anyway, so now the Tana Tuna and the Tana of the Mishnah bring a siyua, bring a help. Gazal chametz ve'avar alav Pesach. Someone who stole 11 bread. Now, the Pesach elapsed over it. So what happened now? The whole idea of the prohibition against driving benefit is over. But we have the rule as what? Chametz she'avar alav Pesach asur be'ana'a. If you have a chametz that passed through the festival of Pesach, you cannot drive benefit from it. Omer lo, the robber said to the victim, Harei shelcha lefanecha. What is yours is before you. So he's fulfilled the mitzvah of returning the stolen item by returning this leavened bread. Even now, it's not worth anything. Remember our discussion, now we're getting close to Sukkot, that etrog, 2 days before Yom Tov, can be $100. Day after Yom Tov can be 30 cents. What's the difference? Just a week and a half.
Well, it could be one day. I mean,
one day?
Yeah, one day, because it's
supply and demand, mister. Well, right?
Plus, also, you can't use it the following year. So if you can't use it for the mitzvah, that's Sukkot, then it's.
So what do you derive from that? Tama, the reason that the robber fulfills his obligation without paying money, it's because the itei be'enei. Because what it was stolen is there the way that it was in its unalterated form. But halitei be'enei. But if that stolen item is no longer the same as it was originally, for example, it was lost, for example, it changes status, right? It's not a fresh lighter you buy in a store in the box. It's already used, right? So therefore, the mitzvah of Hashavat Aveda, the mitzvah of Veshiv et Hagzeila Asher Gazal, the Torah said clearly, you should return the item that was stolen. So Afal gav de hashta, lav mamona. Even now, this item does not have the value. Why? Because Pesach is over, and then is no value, right? Kevan de meikara mamona havi. Since originally. Originally meaning when the time that he was stolen, it was valuable. Ba'ei shalumei. He needs to pay according to what? Full way that it was original. Hachanami. So here too, in our case of stolen a bundle, and then this bundle is now less than pruta, which means a very little value. So afal gav de hashta lo shave pruta, even now it's not even worth $1, right? Kivan de meikara havei shave pruta ba'ei shalume. Since originally it was what? Initially was worth one pruta, you have the obligation to pay. By Rava. So now we have different scenarios of stolen items. Gazal shtei agudot bifruta ve'echzir lo achat mehen. If someone robbed another with two bundles of goods that were worth one pruta, and he returned one of them, mahu? Mi amrinan hashta leka gzela odilma hadar lo halo hadar gzeila dahavai gabei. So hadar pashta. So Rava explained, gzeila en kan, hashava yesh kan. So here you don't have a matter of robbery, but you still have the mitzvah of return. So the Lechem Mishneh in Elchot Gzeila. See, first of all, in the Rambam. The Rambam said, one who robbed another of two bundles worth one pruta in total, and then returned one of them, is not obligated to return the second, although is not considered to have fulfilled the mitzvah of returning a stolen item. As we said, it is a big Lechem Mishneh here. But anyway, the Gemara asks, Igzeila en kan, hashava yesh kan. Even you tell me that holding that bundle, it's like holding the isu gzeila, the prohibition of a stolen item, but returning the item is still the mitzvah. Case of Mishneh, Lechem Mishneh is elaborate, but the key is you have here a contradiction with the word of Rava. Remember, what's the pasuk? What's the sentence? Ve'eshiv et hagzeila asher gazal. We have the obligation to return it. Hache ke'amar afal pi she'egzeila en kan, mitzvah d'ashava en kan. Which means that he can go after him and require him to do what? To return the stolen item. and the robber ought to be exempt, as he's no longer considered to be in the possession of a stolen item. So again, is a tour, and the Rosh in Chosh al Mishpat 360. Now, since we talk about this type of question, we have similar cases. One of the mitzvot of Nazir, if you remember, we learned and instructed Nazir, that when he completed the time of Nazirah, the Torah said in Bamidbar chapter 6, he needs to shave all of his hair. And if, for example, he contaminated with touching a dead body, so he needs to go back. He needs to purify it and start the Nazirut again. So we learn, V'arei amru, Nazir shegilach v'shiyer shtei se'arot. You have a Nazirite who shaved his head but left two hairs. Lo asa v'lo klum. He did not fulfill the mitzvah of giluach. By Rava gilach achat v'nashra achat ma'o. So if he shaved one of them and the other fell out, אמר לרב אחא מדיפתי לרבינה נזיר שגילח אחת אחת כמובא לרבה אמר לו צריכה כגון שנשר אחת מהם וגילח אחת מי אמרים לה שאתה מי הלק השיעור הודיל מהל אב גילוח הוא ומעיקר השיעור שתי שערות אבל אשתה כגילח לא גאו שתי שערות So Rashi here said כלומר הוודאי גילוח הבי So in short What the Rambam said in Ilchot Nezirut, chapter 8, a Nazir who shaved his head but left two hairs uncut has not fulfilled the mitzvah of shaving and must shave again. If a Nazir shaved his head but left two hairs uncut and he later shaved one of the remaining hairs, after which the second fell out, he has fulfilled the mitzvah of shaving. If one of the remaining hairs fell out before he shaved the other, he has not fulfilled the mitzvah of shaving, though he is not required to shave again. So that's what we said, Hadar Pshata. So Rava himself then resolved the quandary, and he said, Se'ar enkan giluach enkan. There is no stolen item here, and there is no returning of stolen item here. So what does that mean? אין שיער, אין כאן גילוח, יש כאן, אחי כאמר, אף על פי שיער, אין כאן מצוות גילוח, אין כאן. So even you don't have a hair, you don't have the mitzvah of גילוח. In the Nazir 46, is a Tanaic disputation, if he fulfilled the mitzvah of גילוח, that, and if it's מעכב for wine and contaminated to the dead person, etc. But the Mefaresh in Nazir 42, And also the Marshal, the Yamshe Shlomo 42, elaborates how far you go with this fulfillment, the Tosfot here. Anyway, V'amar Rabba, Arei Amru, now very similar. Here we're dealing with a earthware that when it's come to a corpse, so they said, Chavit Shenikva Ustamu Ashmarim. So here we're dealing with a barrel that was punctuated and was then sealed by sediments from its content. The sediments have efficiently saved the contents of the barrel from contracting ritual impurity if the barrel were to come into contact with an impure item, as it is once again considered a sealed barrel. חבית שנקבע וסתמו השמרים, הצילוה בעירבה אגב חציה, מהו? So, seal the half of the hole. So, do we say that since the hole is not currently large enough to allow tumah, to allow ritual impurity to penetrate, the barrel is considered sealed? Or, we go the other way, that since the hole was initially large enough to allow impurity to penetrate, and it has not yet been sealed completely, so the barrel retains its status and is not considered sealed. Amar le Rav Yeimar le Rav Ashi, lav mishnatenu hizo, ditnan. Chavit shenikva ustamu ashmarim. We have a barrel that was punctuated and was then sealed by sediment. The sediments have efficiently saved the content of the barrel from contracting ritual impurity. Hitzilua pkaka bizmora, save the content, or pledge the whole with a vine, right? Ad shimareach, until he smears the clay around the uncovered part of the hole. Hayu bashtayim ad shimareach min hatzadim uven zmora lachavarta. When it is two vine placed in the hole in order to plug it, so therefore its content remains susceptible to contracting ritual impurity until he smears clay from the sides of the hole inward and between one vine and the other. So they said, Tama de marach. The reason is for because he smeared the clay over. Ha lo marach lo. If he's not smeared, so it's not. Amai, why? It's not like what the Rava said, Rava Dilema, but they have a kiagav chetzia. So it'll be a seal like a half of the hole, because it's no apparent difference between a hole that half seal and a hole that is a partially plugged into the vine. So Amri Ache Ashta, Atam Ilo Marach lo kiagav chetzia mid de kai kai. So Vamarava, Ramaru, we just said that Chametz, Gazal Chametz Vavar Lava Pesach, right? אומר לו הרי שלך לפניך. So here the Choshen Mishpat in 22. Let's start with this. Let's start with the Rambam, Sefer Tara, Ilchot Tumat Met, chapter 22. An earthquake vessel that has been punctuated and then sealed by the sediment of its content is considered a sealed barrel and protects its content from contacting ritual impurity, provided that it has a tightly sealed cover. If the hole was plugged with a vine, the context remains susceptible to contracting ritual impurity until the sides of the hole are smeared with the clay. If the hole was plugged with two vines, the sides of the hole and the space between the two vines must be smeared with clay. The halacha with regard to tightly covered barrel that was punctuated and partially sealed remain uncertain. That's the Rambam. Now, if one rub another of a chametz, of a leavened bread, and Pesach then elapsed over that, the robber may return the victim as is, despite the fact that the victim now has no use of it. That's also the Choshen Mishpat and 363. So now, by Rava, 105, Nishba Alav Mahu. For example, if the robber took a false oath concerning the robbery of the leavened bread. So the question is, what is the halacha? מי אמרינן כיוון דאים מגנב בי שלום אלי, ממונה ככפר לי. או דילמה השת מיהת המנח ואפרה באלמה ולא כפר לי ממונה. So here the Rambam in הלכות גזלה ועבידה, chapter 3 said, if one robbed another of bread that was later burned or lost, he's obligated to pay the owner the amount that the bread was worth at the time of robbery. Accordingly, if the robber takes a false oath that he did not rob another of the bread, he is obligated to pay the additional 1/5 payment and bring a guilt offering, even if he oath, if his oath was taken after the bread has become forbidden. That's basically the resolution of Rava's dilemma. So milta de bayale le Rava pshita le Rava damar Rava shuri ganavta vumer lo ganavti. Someone said you stole my ox, and the other said I never did it. Mati voetz lecha. What is the virtue of present in your possession? Shomer chinam ani alav. I'm unpaid bailey. Shalei patar atzmo migneva avida, that he is free, exempt himself for what? For liability or case of theft and loss. Shomer sachar ani alav. Shalei patar atzmo mishvura vemeta. If it's a paid bali, so he's exempt from death or breakage. Shoel ani alav and bar of it. Chayav shalei patar atzmo meta mechamat melacha. Exempt himself. Liability in case that the ox died due to the ordinary labor. Alma afal gav de ha kaem kevan de imigniv mamona kakafar ashtaname mamona kakafar achaname afal gav de afra be almau kevan de imigniv bay shalom ele mamona mealia ashtaname mamona kakafar li yativ rava v'amar li v'kamar la shmata eiti v'rav amram li rava v'chichesh ba prat lemode beikar. That's excluding the one who admits to the primary feature of the claim. Keitzad, give me an example. Shori ganavta. If someone said, you stole my ox. Vu omer lo ganavti. Mati vo etzlecha. Ata mecharto li, ata netatno li bematana. Avicha mecharo li, avicha netano li bematana. Achar parati rats meelav ba etzli. Toe baderech mutzatif. Shomer chenam ani alav, shomer sachar ani alav, shoel ani alav. It's all kind of v'nishba voda. He agreed that it was a lie. Yachol yeh chayav talmud lomar v'chichesh ba prat modeh b'ikar. So that's exclude the one who admits to the primary feature of the claim. So here we have the Rambam who said, I'm just reading from the Koran edition, if one steals another's ox and then takes a false oath that he has unpaid bailey of it, he is liable to bring a guilt offering for taking a false oath on a deposit, as by using so, he is exempted himself from liability for theft or loss. Similarly, if he took a false oath that he is a paid bailey, he is also liable since he has exempted himself from liability in cases of breakage and death. Even if he takes a false oath that he is a borrower, he is liable, since he exempt himself from liability should the animal die or deteriorate due to the ordinary labor. Amar le tedura, he said, fool. Kitanya idik amar le hilach ki kamina da kaima be'agam, that it's the standing in a different place, for example, a swamp that is not returned to the owner. Ata mechartoli, for example, you sold it to me, my bode beikar, yikalo tzricha, de amar le lom tatil chad mei, shekil tora bezil. Said to him, you sold the animal to me, but I did not give you the money, take your ox and go. Ata netatoli, avicha netatoli, my bode beikar, it's like almost like an unscrupulous person, right? Play the game. You gave it to me, your father gave it to me, my bode beikar, yikar, he said to him, it was given to me on the condition that I will afford you satisfaction. And I did not do anything for you. Take your ox and go. I found it straying on the road and I brought it home. He said to him, you should return it. I didn't know that it's yours, so I could return it to you. So here, since we talk about different form of oath that the person make when it's come to a lost item, here we have Brighter that dealing with this type of oath. Tanya Amar ben Azai Shalosh Tvuotem. There are three types of a person that take an oath that he doesn't know that that animal was lost, and then he agreed that it was a lie. It's three avenues of oath. Meaning the lie can be in three different ways. We have here Ben Azai, Shmuel, and Rabbi Hanina. Hikir ba velo b'motza'a, b'motza'a velo ba, lo ba velo b'motza'a. So he said either he recognized the lost but did not recognize the finder. So here we have number one, or he recognized the finder but not recognized the item, or neither of them know its finder. So in all of this, the witness took a false oath that he has no knowledge of the lost item, when in fact he had limited knowledge of it. So you see here they have the oath that may be false for one of those three reasons. Lo ba velo metzah, shkushta ishtaba. If neither the item nor the finder, so it's a oath in truth. Eima ba uve motza'a. He said, here you talk about the case where they recognize both the item and its finder. Lemai hilcheta. What exactly the halacha involved with this? They said all these three examples. Amar Rav Ami, Amar Rabbi Chanina, lepatur Shmuel Amar lechiyuv. He said for the liftor to exempt. Shmuel said that liability to bring an offering for these cases. So please, we plug the Dalitana and the Tanya. Hamashbia ed echad. If someone administer an oath to a single witness, patu. Rabbi Elazar ben Shimon mechayev. B'may kamiflig. Yamar davar, mar savar davar gorem lemamon kemamon dami. Says that item that causes financial loss is considered to have a monetary value. Umar savar lav kemamon dami. It's not. So the Rambam said in L'chot Shvuot chapter 10, a single witness who took a false oath that he does not know of any testimony is exempt from bringing an offering for taking a false oath of testimony. It's because the testimony of a single witness cannot impose financial liability. Amar Rav Sheshet, HaKofer bePikadon Na'asa Alav Gazlan V'Chayav Bo'Onasim. If someone falsely deny a claim concerning a deposit becomes a robber with regard to it, and therefore is liable to pay even for damage with the result of accidents. V'tana tuna v'chichesh ba, lamadnu onesh azara minayin. So tamud lomar, lo techachashu. You should not deal falsely. My love, lo onesh mamon, money, denial even of the accidental damage. Lo, it's not the bride speaking about lo onesh vua, additional 1/5 payment and bringing of the offering. Ha mediktane seifa v'ishtaba mechadereisha lo ishtaba, uktane seifa v'nishba al sheker lamadnu onesh azara minayin, tamud lomar lo teshakru. You should not lie. Umide seifa de ishtaba reisha de lo ishtaba. Amrei idi v'idi di ishtaba, kan shehoda, kan shebaru edim. So if you have a witness, it is a little different because you have the witnesses came and testified that the deposit of the is there in the possession. Atu edim chayav bo nasim. Odu ye ode chayav bekeren v'chomesh v'asham. So you see that because the braita here have a reference to both clauses, the case where the belly took an oath, it offers no support for Rav Sheshet's statement. Mativ Rami Bar Chama, uchshnegdo chashud al hashvua keitzad. So Rami Bar Chama, here, challenged that, and he said, when you have the opposite, v'chshenegdo, the opponent, the defender, is suspect with the oath, So how old? So he said, "Echad shvuat I do bechad shvuat afilu shvuat shav." See, we're running out of time, so I just want to share with you a few halachot. Then we continue tomorrow. Just a few things. First, the Rambam in Choshen Mishpat 294, a bailli who falsely denied in court having received a deposit is considered a robber even if he did not take an oath. That is Sma. The Rambam said, provided that there are witnesses who testify that they saw the deposit in his possession at the time of denial. So as a result, a bailli is held responsible even accidental damage as he is disqualified from bearing witness. Rabbi Akiva Iger asked why Rabbi and Rava did not discuss something, davar ha'oven le'omot k'rimamon. But anyway, since we discuss here Ben Sorer Umore, the Chatam Sofer said that when it's come to a rebellious son, Ben Sorer Umore, Nidon al Shem Sofo, you judge him according to the end. You need to give skila. So you ask, why you need the skila? Because if he kills, he needs a saif, but not skila. So he bring a midrash that said that Gazlan, people curse his father. Because what happened? So as a result, caused his father to die. So Danim al Shem Sofo, that he is basically indirectly caused his father to die. So that's the idea of skila. And that's what they said about Yishmael, Ba'asher Usham. What does that mean, Ba'asher Usham? Ba'asher Usham, so Reb David of Lelov said, we just read in Rosh Hashanah, Ba'asher Usham, that said that watch Yishmael, whatever is it. So that's happened with someone who does the teshuva. So you have all these mekatregim, all those who come and said, you know, now in Rosh Hashanah they said something, they behave something, but 2 weeks from now, person will change, will be a different one. So they said, this we learn from Yishmael, Ba'asher Usham, meaning God judge, now you take a serious commitment to be better, so we take it seriously and Ba'asher Usham, and therefore, hopefully God will grant each and every one of us Shana Tova Umetuka, happy and healthy, 5777.